No, sir. And so it came around that he guessed, I do not have the means to represent myself. I request that the court appoint counsel. And they say, I'm sorry, in the state of Florida, we only allow that in terms of a murder or a high felony, capital, you know, that type, anything that would involve possibly a death penalty. And the states had that right. They could, at that time, they believed they had the right to go state to state and say when and how they determined counsel to be appointed. He tried to represent himself, and he said he did as good a job as he could considering the circumstances. He's incarcerated, he didn't even have enough money to post bail, so he's been in jail this whole time since the arrest up to this point, and he loses. And so he gets 5 years in jail. Now, while he's in jail, he writes what they call a certiorari. I'm not very good. Certiorari, which is kind of like a way of going to the Supreme Court and saying, this is my petition. He took it to the state appeals court, and they, of course, turned it down. And this was early 62 at this point. And he's going up and he's saying, well, you know, I am doing this as a pauper, so I can't even afford to file with the Supreme Court the 40 copies I need. I just have this one copy written in pencil on stationery that says you're only allowed 2 letters per week by the Florida State Penitentiary, which is really kind of wild. And somebody notices it. And the Supreme Court justice, the head justice at that time, is Hugo Black. He hated the Betts decision of 42. He regretted it ever since. And it almost seems like maybe he was waiting, and this is subjective, he was waiting for this kind of case to come up so he could right a wrong. And so what happened was they did take it, and they did listen. And by the time he got up to court, it was 1963. He'd already been serving a decent portion of his sentence. And it was determined that the 14th Amendment is all about due process. The states have to follow that, right? Well, what Black decided, and this was a unanimous 9-0 decision, was that those also apply to all the other amendments before it. So Amendment 6, that counts. What's part of Amendment 6? The right to counsel under any circumstances. So therefore, you can't pick and choose as a state what you consider to be due process. It's all or nothing. And that really is also what paved the way for the Miranda rights case that came a little bit after that too. So this was a real landmark. And the funny thing is that people always consider these big landmark cases. When you think about it, the more you go into a lot of these, they're not the greatest people in the world because they're fighting the system in the first place. There was one expert who said, you know what, it's never about the winners, it's about the losers who end up getting these magnificent cases. He still didn't have a fantastic life after this, but it's amazing that one event could change so much. And what's even funnier is that Hugo Black got to decide who was going to fight for Clarence. He picked one of the top 5 lawyers in the country. Mm-hmm. A corporate lawyer to come in and fight against the assistant state's attorney of Florida who had 3 years law experience. Wow. So they hedged it. But here's the problem. After that got passed, everybody's got to retry all these folks from the previous years to say they have a right to counsel. Florida just said, no, we're going to release all 2,000 people that are underneath us. Except for you, Clarence. We're going to retry you. And so he picked his own private lawyer, and they picked the place apart, and it only took 1 hour to get the verdict back, not guilty. So it is just a soap opera and a half.